Hi, everybody. Welcome. We're going to let you all trickle into the room for a few minutes here, so sit tight. I am Nicole Meldahl, Executive Director of Western Neighborhoods Project. Thank you for being here.
Here they come.
Apologies in advance for any unauthorized cat situation that might happen. I did close the doors, but they immediately reopened them. So you can only do so much with two overweight, pushy felines. But again, welcome. This is our very first Open SF History Photography Forum presented by Western Neighborhoods Project. And we're calling this the Richmond Specials Edition because we have as our very special guests tonight, two epic Richmond District photographers. But also it's a play on a term used to describe the predominant architecture style called the Richmond Special in the neighborhood. So not only are we West Side historians, but we make terrible dad jokes as well. And in that spirit, let me tell you a little bit about what we are as an organization. So we launched this virtual programming series to celebrate 10 years of OpenSF history, which kind of blows my mind, to be honest. And that's a program of Western Neighborhoods Project that was created to digitize and make accessible online images from one private collector. And the program has since expanded since that time to include the archives of several other private collectors, but also the archives of local organizations like, really small organizations like the Golden Gate National Recreation Area, and even smaller organizations like Guardians of the City. So we really are trying to help out our neighbors who aren't able to digitize and host their own collections online. We're over 50,000 images strong now, and those are mapped and searchable online at opensfhistory.org. Thanks to the hard work of dozens of volunteers and community members like you who come to events and send us feedback about our different photographs. And for those who don't know, the 501c3 nonprofit behind this program is WNP, which preserves, interprets, and shares the diverse history and culture of San Francisco's West Side. And we were founded by two best friends in 1999, which means we're celebrating 25 years of community history in 2024. So if you're a member, thank you so much for supporting this work. And if not, we encourage you to sign up today. You can do that at outsidelands.org, or you can simply make a donation at the link that you see on the screen right now. Every dollar really does help us do an immense amount of work. We host history walks, as well as virtual and in-person programs like this. We stage exhibitions. We manage a large collection, including lots of massive artifacts from the Cliff House auction that we saved a few years ago. And we also have a bi-weekly podcast if you're into that sort of thing. It's called Outside Land San Francisco, and you can find it just about anywhere you can find podcasts. So really quick, before we get on with the show, I've got a little bit of rules of engagement for you. So this is a webinar, and it is being recorded. So you'll be able to find it on the WNP YouTube channel soonish after the event is over. Because it's a webinar format, you are muted for the duration of the program, but please feel free to ask questions in the chat. And our director of programs, Chelsea Sellen, who you see here on screen with us, she'll be managing the chat and make sure that those questions get passed along to us here on stage in the Zoom room. And as always, I'm going to ask you to please be respectful of each other and for our guests here. And I know we're a good group. I probably don't have to worry about this, but it's a PSA to those commenting on the YouTube channel after this event has ceased recording. So let's all be nice to each other and have a great time. What do we think, guys? Are we ready to get moving?
Let's go.
Let's do it. Okay. So what we've built as an archive at OpenSF History is an archive that shares the work of San Francisco photographers, from amateur snapshots to the widely reproduced work of professionals. And because the photos we take now will be the historic archives of tomorrow, we're using this forum to celebrate and share the work of contemporary photographers. And we're starting with two of my favorite neighborhood photographers, Dave Glass and Yameen. So thank you for being with us today, Dave and Yameen.
Thanks so much for having us.
So this will be an informal chat that I have deeply structured because I'm nervous about public programs, but why don't we start off with you, Dave, giving a little bit of background of who you are and how you started getting into photography.
Well, excuse me, native San Franciscan, yay. from the Western Addition, yeah. And live out in the outer Richmond, make that the outer Richmond. I'm way out there by the ocean. Let's see, the first time I got into photography, I guess a lot of my photography influence early on was from my father, who had an old battered Leica camera, and he let me use it a few times when I was a teenager, and I just struggled with that thing. And thought I better upgrade. And then I went to a camera store and got myself a real camera. I was probably about 14 or 15. Joined the photography club at Lowell High School and enjoyed it and started taking pictures of friends and stuff. And then, you know, at the time, this was like, you know, late 60s, you know, I considered photography as a profession. So I went to City College, studied photography in their program in 1969 through 1970, and thought that I was going to be a professional photographer. Of course, it didn't quite work out that way, but nevertheless, after City College, which was around 1972 is when I finished, I continued to take photographs, and instead of being a professional photographer, I just, you know, took pictures of all around the city, all around the Bay Area, travel a little bit. And then occasionally I provided photos for local newspapers like the Bay Area Reporter and the New Mission News and a couple others. And I just continue to take photos, and, you know, half a century later, I'm still here, still taking photos. And some of them you're going to get to see in this program.
Just some of them. I know your archive is massive. And Yameen, I think you started with photography in high school too, right?
I actually started earlier than that. I think I was about 7 years old. I had a 110 film camera, they called it spy cameras. It was made by Fisher Price. And I think that was my first camera. Then I got a Polaroid and I had that for a while. But then, yeah, in high school, I got a little SLR and started taking film classes in high school. And that's where I learned the whole darkroom process and loading my own film and making prints. And I fell in love with that. And then I just continued shooting until I was an adult. And I was born in Philadelphia. Started working with a hip hop group when I was in high school, which I believe we will get a little bit into later on. They're called Hieroglyphics out of Oakland, California. And I started making constant trips out to the Bay, quickly fell in love with it, moved temporarily in 2001 and then a little more permanently in 2004. That's how long I've been out here now, and lived in the inner Richmond for 3 years, or excuse me, inner Sunset for 3 years. And I've been in the Richmond since 2008. So West Side the whole time, more or less.
Well, West Side is the best side. And we'll count Western Addition for the purposes of this show. It does have Western in the title. So I think we can adopt it to have you in our zone, Dave, for your entire lifespan. And I love photography. I'm not a photographer, although I do take photos, not anywhere near you guys. But one of the things I love chatting with photographers about are their influences. And I know, Dave, that you've listed Robert Frank and Walker Evans as two of your major influences. And I have to say that those two photographers, I see the through line in both of your works. There's this love of vernacular subject matter that you see in Walker Evans. And there's an Americanness that, like Jack Kerouac describes in this book, which I'm going to plug, by Robert Frank, that runs throughout both of your works. Can you talk a little bit about your photography influences and how it's kept you going as a photographer?
Well, I guess I'll go first. Well, first of all, Walker Evans influenced many generations of photographers. And I had read early on that as a young man, he spent a year in Paris. And that sort of stuck with me because I did the same thing. I wasn't there for a whole year, but I was there a half a year, taking photos in Paris and having that experience. But his style of photography, although he worked with large format mostly, and you know I use small cameras, but his subject matter is very influential to, you know, to photographers, you know, starting from the 1930s when he worked really up until now. And when I look at his photos, you know, I think to myself, there is a similarity. So obviously he is an influence for me, but definitely Robert Frank is the big influence. I mean, he has a style of photography that transformed, you know, conventional methods of how we see through the lens. I mean, before Robert Frank, you know, photography was like very, very standard and conventional and documentary in style. It was not considered, you know, a source of an art form yet. But Robert Frank changed all of that. And then when he produced his book, The Americans, you know, that created, you know, an entire new genre of photography. It changed everything. It's almost like when movies changed, when French New Wave appeared and the British New Wave and then in film noir, Robert Frank changed photography in sort of the same way.
The way he takes photographs almost has a jazz sensibility to it, which makes sense that Jack Kerouac would have written the intro to it. But I know you love jazz too. And sure. I can see there's sort of like a jazz of the streets that both of you are able to capture when you're out and finding things that catch your eye.
Yeah, for sure. But also, you know, one more note about Walker Evans, Walker Evans is, you know, he started out as working for the government for the Farm Security Administration, the FSA, you know, along with a lot of other great photographers. And for all you young folks watching out there, you know, the FSA was a government sponsored photography to document the Great Depression, more or less. And, you know, Walker Evans, Dorothea Lange, many, many others, started out there. And then a lot of those same photographers went on to work for Life magazine, which is another of my influences. And for those who've never seen one, this is a Life magazine. And from the 1930s up and through the 80s, Life magazine was like the picture magazine of the United States and maybe other countries around the world. And they had the best photographers and the best photography. They had an issue every week. And, you know, so many families like mine when I was young subscribed to Life magazine. So I used to look through the magazine and I saw the photographer's work in there. And I thought, boy, that's what I want to do. But that was definitely an influence for me as well. And Walker Evans did not work for Life magazine, but like photographers like Robert Capa, Gordon Parks, Peter Stackpole, Eugene Smith, Margaret Bourke White. I mean, it's like a long, long list. And, you know, I would say that was a very, very big influence for me.
How about you, Yameen? Did any of your musical background impact the way you take photography?
There's a couple of music photographers who certainly inspired me. Jamel Shabazz off the top of my head. There's another one that I am not recalling at the moment, but I think somewhat naively, I just never really learned myself about photographers. And I think I was more inspired by cinematography and movies because that's what I had access to. I didn't start buying photography books until a couple of years ago and kind of learning about, you know, the greats. I think I've been more inspired by contemporary artists like, you know, Dave and Michael Jang, for example. But yeah, I think movies kind of framed my eyes, so to speak, to use a metaphor, about how to picture scenes and compositions more than anything.
Yeah. And so, okay, for our audience out there, now you kind of understand like how our two photographers got to where they are and their influences. So you can really deep dive into the photos we're about to show you. And to start off, just to give some background on how we all came together, Dave, I met you because of John Lindsay of the Great Highway Gallery when we had the Museum at the Cliff pop up in the former Cliff House restaurant and gift shop. There was a great photo show that John curated and he picked you. And I couldn't believe it. I was very excited because I loved your photography for a really long time. And he didn't pick Yameen, which was a terrible decision. I'm sorry, John. I know he's listening. But we did get Yameen access to the Cliff House because that's what we do. Together, we give Yameen access to as many weird old buildings as we can. But what is it about locations like this that are so special to photographers like you?
To me specifically?
Sure, to both of you.
I think for this shot, the building was so empty and lonely and strange that I just instantly fell in love with it. And yeah, I really appreciated you giving me the opportunity to just kind of roam around. And I have some other shots that are straight up creepy kind of, and it was just a great experience. Anytime you offer me a chance to go into weird buildings, I'm all about it. And I really appreciate that.
I mean, it's a win-win, right? Not only do we get to capture some of these historic spaces that are maybe in transition, but it's done in a really artistic way, which like adds to the value of these documentary artifacts. And Dave, you were so kind. You came by the Cliff House a lot.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the Cliff House is such an iconic and historic building. And, you know, I remember the Cliff House when, you know, Sutro's was still operating and the SkyTram was running and Playland at the beach. I mean, you know, I grew up in the Western Addition, but at a young age, we moved out to the Sunset. So I'm really more of a Sunset kid. And we went to Playland a lot, and we went to the Cliff House and Sutro's a lot. And it was really cool when you put that exhibition together. It was really cool, like, to walk around in there again, you know, after so many years, and especially, you know, in the restaurant kitchen, that was like really cool. You know, the old Cliff House restaurant kitchen. I mean, who gets to go in there, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, definitely the Cliff House is just such an iconic place. And, you know, walking through those rooms and seeing, you know, the historic artifacts that Nicole, you put in there, from, you know, from Western Neighborhood Project, and, you know, big shout out to John Lindsay. Hey, John Lindsay, and all the other photographs that were there. I mean, that was really a great exhibit.
It was really fun. We didn't pay Dave to say that, but we appreciate it. It was really fun. And we actually recorded a podcast with you, which listeners, if you want to listen to later after this program is done, it's episode 463, I think. Highly recommend it. It's a really fun episode with John and another photographer we had in the show. And then you both show up whenever I ask you to, which is such a godsend, like tonight. And we both came together again, or we all came together again at our birthday party at the Four Star Theater, which you've captured here, Yameen, in all of its glory. And is this before the renovations, Yameen?
Yeah, this is, I mean, I guess this falls in line with, you know, part of the documentation aspect of my work for sure. And I believe Dave's as well, if I may speak for him, but just being able to record our city as it evolves, it's constantly changing. And you can kind of see in the background, there's some tarps on that building because it was fairly new, and parts of this facade for Four Star has already been updated and changed. So yeah, this is like an older Four Star at this point, which I didn't really quite realize until you mentioned it. This shot was taken early in the morning on an obviously foggy night, and it was always lit up like this. I'm not sure if they still do it, but at the time they lit everything up 24/7.
Isn't it terrifying when your own work starts to become historical? It's not, it's like a really great feeling, but also not a great feeling at the same time. And then our birthday party was a live podcast recording with another photographer, Michael Jang. And I'm going to let Yameen explain the photos on screen, because this is, if I could, I could die happy as executive director of WNP after this moment happened.
Yeah, this was great. So if you're listening and you're not already a WNP member, I highly recommend it. It gives you access to amazing events like this taken inside that movie theater. And this is a picture of my daughter holding my camera. Dave is next to her, coaching her through some techniques here. And then the photograph on the right is the result of this shot. And this is Michael Jang, a very, I would say, popular street photographer, artist, obviously from San Francisco, judging by his hat. But yeah, this was a great moment.
And
I don't
Dave,
know, Dave. Yeah.
Do you give free lessons to anybody's kids who want to learn photography?
Absolutely. Well, I remember that moment because she was just getting ready to take the shot. And I thought for a moment, maybe she would struggle to find the shutter button or something. So I just sort of helped her just a little bit. And then, boom, she got a great picture of Michael Jang. I mean, look, that's the best picture of Michael Jang I've seen.
I mean, she's got some good genes. That's for sure.
Oh, yeah.
I was joking before this that I can't wait to host a forum with Yameen's daughter in 10 years. But so, like, which is a long, this is all a long way of saying of, like, we're all into the same stuff and we live in the same neighborhood and we're so lucky to all, like, work together and keep, like, crossing paths with each other. And when I put this show together, I didn't really think about this intersection, which came to light after we, you know, started chatting about what we could talk about. So you both have a connection to laundromats in general. It's a photography subject that appears in your work, but this laundromat specifically has an interesting intersection. So Dave, why don't you explain what the Little Hollywood Laundrette is?
Sure. Little Hollywood Laundrette existed beginning in 1966, and it was originally opened by my father. And then over the years, he sold it to a relative, and that relative sold it to somebody else. And then by 1989, it was just this kind of old rundown laundromat. It's on Market and Laguna, so it's like in the Hayes Valley neighborhood, fringe of the Castro district. And so I took it over and fixed the place up. That's me. I was a career appliance repairman. So I fixed all the machines. And then I decided to take it one step further. And I had artists come in there and paint murals on the walls. And I filled the place with, you know, vintage photographs. And then with the bar, the Orbit Room bar next door, we sort of formed a sort of a partnership so that we can get customers in both of our businesses and stayed open late. And it turned out to be just a wonderful scene. But basically, this was the culmination of 20 years of being an appliance repairman and then ended up owning and running the Little Hollywood Laundrette, which was really like a dream job for me.
And Yameen, what is it about laundromats that have captured your photographic attention?
I think it just goes back to entering weird buildings randomly and seeing scenes like this. This one is in the Inner Sunset and just looks straight out of the maybe 70s or 80s, just so old school looking, instantly caught my attention. This one a little more modern. This one's in the Richmond, but I just love that facade, that painting on the left.
There is like a quality of timelessness to laundromats. A lot of them, as you mentioned, they haven't been updated in years, but it's also this really great space where all kinds of different San Franciscans interact, right? Like everyone's got to do laundry, and a lot of buildings in San Francisco don't have laundry on premises. So like, I've always been drawn to laundromats as well. And so I'll let you two explain how your lives have intersected in a really interesting way with this photo.
I would say,
go ahead, Yameen.
Okay. Earlier, as I was alluding to earlier, with the hip hop group that I worked with, Hieroglyphics, one of the members was Del the Funky Homo Sapien, or I should say is a member, Del the Funky Homo Sapien. And that's him up there. And I'll let Dave explain what's going on. I'll just point out that Del and I are wearing essentially the same outfit today, which is awesome.
Sure. So I was approached by a filmmaker who wanted to make an MTV video in my laundromat. And this was 1994, I believe. It might have been 93, but I think it was 94. And they said it's going to be Del the Funky Homo Sapien. I thought, you know, I never heard of him. I'm a jazz guy. I don't know anything about hip hop and rap music. So I wasn't really knowing what to expect. And then I thought I'd have to close my store, and they were gonna, you know, shoot music in there or something. But what ended up happening is they allowed the store to be open and running because they wanted the customers in there to be part of the MTV video. And then here's Del, he's on top of the soap machine there, and you can see the artist murals in the background. In this photograph, and there it was like a huge production, you know, with all the grip trucks parked all up and down the street, and there must have been like, you know, 25 or 30 crew members, you know, plus Del, and they produced this like wonderful video called Made in America, which I believe was used in the closing credits of the movie, also called Made in America, with Whoopi Goldberg and Ted Danson.
Were you part of this, Yameen, or was this before your time with the group?
This was 1 year before my time. I started with them in 95. So, it looks like this mural, which is amazing, by the way. It looks like it says 94, maybe, but...
So we do have a video. We're going to play the full video for it for you all, because it's incredible the way you see the laundromat. Please don't sue us, distribution company or Dell, because this is going on YouTube later. And I hope this works.
Made in America, where I get placed on the totem pole, I got sold, cause I'm a black man, never selling crack in track the police. The facts I release go straight through your ear to the mind. Listen, just cause this man is white, I won't diss him. Howling this stuff, work the system, it's a big country, ain't nobody snunky. Be cool, don't lose control, cause the fools go someone else before himself. There ain't no need to be hurt, proceed to be alert, proceed is in the verse. But you ain't got no host to look, you're gonna find them there. And the time is shit. Time together, maybe climb together, but if it don't work out, still don't doubt about it. It's out in the open, hoping that it ain't scaring you. This is made in America. Made in America. Made in America. Made where? Made in America. Made in America. Made in America. Made in America. Bring about a raid in your area. Who's controlling who? You controlling you. Don't let no one tell you what to do. No, you're your own person. I'll be thirsting for more information to deal with the nation. Be forewarned, the more informed you all will help swarm the barbarians of the sleeve again. Ask your elders, I'm sure they'll tell you where you came from, if your brain's not from wondering, where did you come from then? Ask your moms to drop the bomb. Just remember, black is black, no matter the shade, be glad that you gave birth to you. It might hurt you too. You got a wonderful life, so take it like yeah. Protection makes you feel fit. It's a fix when you don't get along. I'm strong and white, just politely prepare you if you're made in America. Because it ain't always fair when you need a strong foundation when your patient's stationed in America. Made in America.
Could you ever imagine, Yameen, you would be on a photography forum?
No, that was such a great realization when we came up with that connection. That video was directed by Michael Lucero, who did quite a few hip hop videos, and he did a few for Hieroglyphics specifically, including the 93 Till Infinity video, which is really popular. So he was a great director.
Do you know what bar that was that they were in, Dave?
I don't know the bar, but you know it might have been in the Castro, because they did some other scenes there over by the Castro Theater, so it might have been one of the bars across the street, maybe. And then it could have been the Orbit Room, but it didn't look like the Orbit Room to me.
Yeah, I mean, this is what's crazy about doing history, and like, you know, I just feel like there's always these connections that pop up once you start chatting. So you're into laundromats, you guys have the Delk connection, which is crazy and awesome. I also see cars popping up in all of your photographs. Dave, I know you're a car guy. What's going on with cars? Why do you love cars so much?
Good question. Well, you know, living in the Sunset as a teenager, car culture was really big out there. I lived near 21st and Taravelle. And all the teenage kids, I mean, that this was the muscle car era, the mid-60s, the muscle car era. And kids were like, you know, fixing up these, you know, Mustangs and 57 Chevys and stuff. And then, you know, they didn't just fix them up. They take them down to the Great Highway and drag racing. And so I went down to the drag races, and I didn't have a muscle car. But some of my friends did, and I'd sit in the back seat and, you know, flooring it down, all the way down the length of the Great Highway and back. And it was really kind of scary, but it was fun. And, you know, if my mom were alive, she'd probably be a little upset to learn that I drag raced her 66 Catalina a couple of times. But that was sort of, you know, part of the culture in the Sunset. There was really a car culture out there, you know, kind of a greaser culture, to be honest. And, you know, I used to work on cars and motorcycles, and that was sort of how I got into being an appliance repairman, because I knew how to work with tools. I knew how to get my hands greasy, you know, and wear coveralls and that sort of stuff. And so now, you know, like I still see car culture out here on the West Side. I see it quite a bit. And, you know, inside a lot of those garages, like you can see in this photograph here, inside a lot of those garages in the Richmond and Sunset are like old cars are parked in there that people have either saved or they restored or they don't run or they're waiting for parts or whatever. So there's, you know, definitely a car culture out here.
Every time I walk around the neighborhood, I always wonder what is stashed behind that garage door. Or, I mean, I think about you guys with your photo archives too. Like, what is going on in these buildings? I know something cool is in here. And Yameen, it pops up in your photography too. Did you start the hashtag a Sunday car pick?
No, definitely not. No, I mean, growing up on the East Coast, definitely car culture was a little bit different. I remember in the 90s, Jeeps were big and SUVs started to come out. There was like the Honda had like a SUV that was popular. But once I moved to California, I mean, it's just night and day difference. You see cars like this, or vans rather, like this all over the place. And yeah, they catch my eye for sure. Not so much on Instagram when you're taking pictures of newer cars. I've tried, you know, Hyundai Elantras. I think it's 20 years too early, maybe. Let's wait a little bit. Nissan Ultimas, short a hit in a couple of years. But yeah, it has to be classic cars for the Instagram.
Fair enough. And Dave, you've got so many shots. It was hard to pick which ones of your photographs, both of you, to put in this. But I love this photo because it shows someone working on cars. Maybe you're working on the car. But the composition of the way the cars are angled is so gorgeous.
Yeah, I'm working on the car. That's my truck over there on the right side. You can see my tools. And that's my wife's car, you know, 59 Pontiac Bonneville. And my truck, that was a 1953 Chevy pickup truck. That was my work truck. That's my dog. And I used to just keep a camera in the glove box of my truck. And if I just felt like taking a picture, even if my hands were greasy, I just go in there and take a shot and then put the camera back in. And that's pretty much how I got this photo.
Both of you have such strong lines in all of your shots. It's what really, it's a hallmark of both of your work. I love this shot. I mean, it's so simple and so beautiful and says West Side in so many ways.
Yeah, thank you. This was shot in the Richmond. You can just see that steep incline. And yeah, I really like this one too. The way that all the colors are so similar. This one's a personal favorite.
I think in detail shots is when you can really see when a photographer is a great photographer, because anyone can take a photo of the Golden Gate Bridge and it'll like look pretty decent. But when you can make this photo look great, you know you're really doing something. Same with the last shot, Dave. And like the cool thing about what you all are doing here, not to just like gratuitously make this connection, but like you all are street level, like capturing the culture on the West Side, which is shifting. Like that's the scary thing about cities in flux, right? That even as you're taking this photograph, like the culture that is making the photograph happen is changing in different ways. So Dave, what's going on in this photo?
Well, obviously that's a low rider and he is showing off his low rider skills, as you can see. But in this particular case, I mean, he was able to like maintain that angle long enough for me to take a photo. I thought that was cool. But you know what's going on here is every third Sunday of each month, there's a gathering of old car buffs that come out to Ocean Beach. This is like out like pretty much across the street from Beach Chalet, and they all show up. It's in the morning, like 8 o'clock till about 10 or 11. So it's, you know, it doesn't last very long, but the people who come out there, I mean, it's not like, you know, fancy restored, you know, Jaguars and Mercedes Benzes. It's just a lot of like, you know, the cars that are in the garages all over the Richmond and Sunset, you know, some of them are low riders. There's some are rusty cars, you know, some are restored, some are half restored, and you know, people bring their kids and they you know, they have coffee in the morning and stuff out there, and so that's when I took this photo. And of course you could see you know, the Ocean Beach promenade in the background there, and it's just such a delightful experience to go out there every third Sunday, and I'd recommend it for whoever's watching and listening.
A lot of WNP members bring their cars to that on the regular, I will say. And, mm-hmm. you know, this really does capture the essence of the neighborhood. Not as much as this photo, which I know you two have a lot to say about, but this human being is one of the reasons why I'm a big advocate of the Sunset District.
Yeah, this is James Kirk. He legally changed his name to that. It may be James T. Kirk, named after Star Trek's pilot. or captain rather. And yeah, he is the owner of the Starship House, which is an amazing, very San Francisco, I don't even know what to call it, event. It's a thing. It's great. And he's standing here in front of his Batmobile replica. You can kind of see the bat symbol down at the lower left. And I'm so glad I was able to capture his dog in the passenger seat. But yeah, Dave, I think you would know him personally, right?
Well, yeah, not personally, but, you know, that's, you know, I just call him Captain Kirk. And, you know, if you ask him, he'll give you a tour in his house. And in his living room, he's got like a giant replica of the Starship Enterprise. So like, if you're a Star Trek buff, you know, go out there on some Sunday and ask Jim, and he'll take you up there and let you see his, you know, his living room. It's really, really something.
If I remember correctly, he was in danger of losing the house a while ago, and there was a whole article on it, a Kickstarter campaign, and San Francisco really showed up to make sure this uniquely San Francisco experience didn't go away. So if you're ever at, it's off Terraval, if you're ever at Whitecap for a drink or the Riptide, wander over and see if you can get a free tour of this incredible experience.
Yeah, he's on 46th Avenue between Terraval and Santiago.
And like, this is just another example of like, there's such a rich, like, cultural lifestyle out here at the beach. It's kind of a beach lifestyle, but not like a Southern California beach lifestyle. There's just there's so many unique characters here.
Yeah, that's Yuri. And, you know, I've seen Yuri out there a few times. I haven't seen him in a few years, but, he's, you know, he's a Russian gentleman, and he gives you know, music lessons, but he also, you know, will fix your fence and do your gardening and whatever. You could see his advertising on the back of his van there. And, you know, what he does is he'll go out there and play his accordion out at Ocean Beach and try to drum up a little business. He's a real character.
And Yameen, how did you find this lovely lady?
Yeah, this was just one of those random days. I was just wandering a neighborhood I've never been in before with a camera. And I was across the street and I saw her, and I literally ran across the street like a weirdo and got in front of her and just took this picture. And yeah, this is another one of my favorites.
How do you approach people? This has been one of my biggest fascinations with street photography, is how you get the courage to approach people to ask if you can take a photograph.
For me, I used to not ask. This was, I did not ask permission to take this. I just took it. And I still do that occasionally. But more recently, I've been asking for portraits. That's actually what I've been working on the most, is street portraits, street portraiture. And for the most part, I'd say 90% of it, I ask permission. But yeah, I kind of got tired of people yelling at me. Someone chased after me one time. So I just don't need that right now. So I've been asking permission.
Dave, have you ever been chased?
Yep, I have a couple of times. But you know, most of my photography is not really portraiture where I'm asking people to pose. I do, you know, more of a candid style of taking photographs, but occasionally, you know, I'll strike up a conversation with somebody like this gentleman here on Terraval Street, and, you know, I'll speak with him. And then, you know, once I've established a little bit of trust, then I'll ask if I can take his photo. And then I think you have a better chance of getting a, you know, a quality image.
Because you ride your bike all over town, right?
I do. So a lot of my photos are on bike level. So, you know, sometimes when you roll up on a bike, people are more comfortable than if you walk up to them. So that's sort of part of the reason. But also, I can really cover a lot of ground on a bike. You know, I mean, I've ridden my bike from the outer Richmond to downtown and, you know, Market Street and the ferry building and back, you know, a few times. And so that's covering a lot of ground, and you can take a lot of photos between here and there, you know, off a bicycle seat. And I was sitting on my bike when I took this photo.
Are you on a bike too, Yameen?
No, I'm typically walking.
with your daughter, or is it a solo enterprise?
Yeah, a lot of the pictures, I would say a majority of my pictures, my family is close by, and I think they're used to it at this point. I'll just dip away and then I'll come back. If I'll see something and I'll chase it and then I'll just come back. But yeah, I would say the majority of my photos are taken like that.
There's another photographer I follow on Instagram. Their handle is Relax Baby Be Cool. And I saw them, it's this dude and his girlfriend. I saw them out in front of my house and I was like, oh, this is what it's like behind the camera, where he's just taking photos of everything and she's just patiently following him. And that's how I always think about you wandering the neighborhood too, Yameen.
Yeah, they don't wait for me. I have to catch up.
So Dave, this is a great example of that sort of like candid style of photography you were talking about.
Sure. This photo, this is an older photo from the 70s. And this is on the corner of 8th and Balboa in a little market called Fresh Today. And it's funny because, you know, the Korean man who owned the store, he didn't know any English except two words. He said, fresh today. So if you asked him anything, like, you know, do you have this or that, all he would say is fresh today. So but anyway, he was a real nice man. But what's happening here is there's a couple of guys who are doing like a little martial arts demonstration, you know, for the neighborhood. And so a couple of the neighbors came out to watch.
Yeah, why not? And this is more your portraiture style, right, Yameen?
No, this one too was, I didn't ask permission. I just took this one. It was too good not to. I saw him there and yeah, it was perfect.
And this is, where is this photo taken?
This is past Chrissy Field. I don't know what it's called.
I think that's the old torpedo wharf, like the warming hut's just out of frame, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite spots in the city. And we do claim that as part of the West Side. That's like on the edge, but we do claim it. And you, Dave, you also captured just such a great, like, folks working in the neighborhood. Like, who is this and what's he doing?
He's a guy who came to paint my house. And it was just before I moved from this house to a different place. This is on 8th Avenue. On 8th Avenue between Balboa and Cabrillo. But one of the things I love about this picture is that old boombox radio that you can see in the picture. I don't know if you all can see much detail or not, but those D-size batteries held in with duct tape is sort of what caught my attention on this shot. And he's on a ladder out there. He's standing on a ladder, but he's pretty high up. He's on, you know, above the second floor.
The way you elevate subject matter like this to like a fine art is what I think connects you most to Robert Frank. He was really noted for doing that originally and like pulling out this Americanness. I see that so deeply through all of your photographs. And the way you're able to get people, you're able to capture who people are on film really, really well. Just their essence, people seem just so comfortable with you. I don't know how you manage that.
Yeah, he was unloading. I think he was helping someone move, or he was part of like a moving company. And I walked by and then I was like, I got to go ask. And I ran back and asked, and he was surprised at first. But then, yeah, we got this shot.
It's so invaluable the way you both capture people and places on the West Side. Dave, we ran this photo during our PR and so many people commented, this was a Fred Lyon photograph. It has to be.
Yeah, this is Children's Playground, Golden Gate Park, you know, and I think the playground has been redone a couple of times since this picture was taken. And that's my young daughter at the very top. And that's why I took the photo. But I just happened to snap it at a moment when, you know, a lot was going on. But around the slide with all these kids. But, you know, when I was a young boy, I used to go down that very same slide, you know, growing up in San Francisco. And Children's Playground in San Francisco was just this marvelous place, you know, with the carousel. And there was actually two of those spiral slides. And I'm sure if anybody's watching this, if you know, are from my generation and you are from San Francisco, you probably remember this slide here. Nowadays, I can't imagine, you know, with all the, you know, litigation, safety litigation and so on, I can't imagine one of these still being around, but it sure was then. And you can tell that the kids loved it.
I was born in 1984, and I like to joke that I was the last generation for dangerous playground equipment. Like after us, they were like, this is bad. We shouldn't let them get on these things that just burn your flesh off when you go down them. But there's another famous photographer connected to this slide, right, Dave?
Dorothea Lange took a very similar photograph of the very same slide. And it's in one of her books. I can't remember which one, but I think her photograph's better than mine because she stood back a little bit and got the whole thing. But yeah, definitely Dorothea Lange.
Yeah, but your daughter's not in Dorothea Lange's photo, so.
No.
Did you tell her this is the Dorothea Lange slide?
No, I didn't tell her that. I told her it was mine, but, you know, in this photo, my daughter is about 5 years old, maybe, and now she's in her mid-50s, so, you know, this is an old photo.
This is one of my, so I love Mel's. It's where it was my first pandemic meal out, and we'll get more into the pandemic later, but you do a great job of capturing neon, Yameen.
Thank you. I believe this might have been at the very start of the pandemic. I know they eventually posted boards up and accepting takeout, but I think it was right before then. And it was very early in the morning. It was just before sunset. And it's a little sketchy having like this was taken on a large medium format camera on a tripod and standing out on Geary, like by myself with, you know, at 5 in the morning or whatever it was, 4 in the morning. It was a little sketchy, but yeah, I got the shot and I really like this one too.
Mel's has a long history here on the West Side. This one in particular has a deep like civil rights history, which we have a podcast about, not to make it all about WNP, but like it really is one of the best breakfasts in town. One of the best priced mimosas as well for those listening who that resonates with, but also beautifully captured here. Another icon of the West Side captured by Dave as well.
Yeah, I threw this one in because now the trees have all grown and you can't see the bottom half of the Dutch windmill anymore from this angle. This photograph was taken in 87, and I remember that day because I was on my bike and I was on my way to the Golden Gate Bridge, which was having its 50th anniversary that day. You know, so that was like in May of 87, I believe. And I took this photograph with like this ancient Kodak tourist, you know, medium format folding camera. So I was sort of experimenting with this at the time. But, you know, when I took this photo, I had no idea that the trees were going to like almost completely cover, you know, the view of the windmill from that angle.
Accidental historic documentation. And this seems like a really traditional landscape photo. It's not what you normally gravitate towards. So,
yeah, that's true. I'm not much of a landscape photographer. You know, landscape photography sort of needs, you know, medium format, you know, to get all the detail. You know, small 35 millimeter, you know, landscape photography doesn't really work. Digital cameras, absolutely. But not so much 35 millimeter film cameras. So yeah, this is one of the few landscapes that I took, but I just have this fascination with the windmills. And right now I live like really close to this one. So I walk past it all the time. And it's just such one of San Francisco's most interesting and beautiful landmarks.
Yeah, that's why we did a whole exhibition on it at the end of last year, actually. It was really great. Like, I love them too. And you mean, this is one of my favorite shots because I feel like this era of architecture is now starting to come into its own, but you have captured it beautifully here.
Thank you. Yeah, I believe it's mid-century. It's such a standout in the neighborhood. I don't really see many quite like this. I don't know, Dave, have you seen anything similar to this?
Not really. I mean, there's a lot of mid-century, architecture, but in San Francisco, but they don't usually look like this. I mean, this almost looks like they wanted to be a motel, but decided to be an apartment building. And you just don't see many of these. But, you know, as the Richmond district kind of filled out, I know, Nicole, you mentioned the Richmond specials, and they would tear down a small house and build like a 4-unit building with like very weak architecture, to put it mildly. That was more like the 70s, I think, the 70s. But in the 50s, there was still quality, you know, mid-century architecture happening. And, you know, you could tell by the construction of the windows that you could see in the this photograph, in the foreground of the photograph, that, you know, this is a quality architecture. But no, you don't see many of these at all, in San Francisco, anywhere in San Francisco.
The color tones in your photographs, Yameen, are so gorgeous. How do you achieve those?
I really rely on the film to do it. I have digital cameras and I use them quite a bit, but the workflow is more tedious for me. So I really just prefer to pick up some film and let it do most of the work. I still edit film photos, but I would say a lot of this sort of color reproduction comes from the film itself.
And again, just another car photo from Dave. Dave, is that, do you know who's working on that car?
I don't, but you know, I saw right away when I took this photo, it looked like, you know, a big fish is about to swallow that guy. And I'm not sure what kind of a car that is. It's a Dodge or a Plymouth. It looks like one of those business coupes, you know, where traveling salesmen would use a business coupe because they had great big trunks where they can put their samples in. This is really typical. This is in the sunset, outer sunset, and, you know, the guy's working on his car out in the driveway, and, you know, my next door neighbor works on his car in his driveway, and it's this guy's working on his, and you see a scene similar to this, except not necessarily with an old car, but you see scenes like this all over the Richmond and Sunset. And, you know, I'd love to see that because, you know, there's a lot of neighborhoods where you can't do that. There's just no sidewalk space, or it's just not feasible. But yeah, I love this photo.
It's a slower pace of life out here in the suburbs of the city. The last weekend, when it was sunny, everyone in my neighborhood was out washing their cars. Like, every individual neighbor just decided to do this. And I snapped a photo of it too. And I was like, you know, this is why we live out here. And I made a joke that this should be like an advertisement for California. And you were like, oh yeah, this has been used in packaging.
Yeah, Lomography used this in their film packaging for some of their film recently. This is the Ocean Beach. Sorry, yeah.
No, sorry, yeah, because such an iconic shot.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's right below the Cliff House, I think, on Ocean Beach.
And so you capture the life in the city so well. But, did Chelsea, you pop in because you have a question?
Yeah, we have a question from Isabella, who wants to know, for both Dave and Yameen, do you take multiple shots at once or just single shots?
I usually take single shots and maybe a second. I don't burn through a lot of film, you know, like some photographers do. I just don't like to waste the film. Film has always been a little bit expensive, especially compared to digital. But, you know, back in the day, I would take, you know, if I thought I was shooting an important scene, I would take, you know, multiple shots. But when you're doing street photography, you really only get one chance. You hope that you get it on that first shot, and then maybe you have an opportunity to take a second shot.
Yeah, exactly what Dave said. The only exception being that I can think of is if I'm on location for something like Western Neighborhood Projects and I have some freedom to move about and experiment a little bit, but typically I don't think I take more than two shots, if only one.
Any more questions, Chelsea?
No, we're good for now. Please continue with the program.
Thank you. So yeah, you're out there capturing day-to-day life, but you both have been able to capture really incredible and seminal events in San Francisco history. And we'll start with Dave. Dave, you were in the Western Addition when redevelopment was happening. And if you could maybe briefly explain what redevelopment was and what you're capturing here.
Sure. Well, just to make it as brief as possible, because it's really a big comprehensive story with many chapters and many layers. But in the mid-century, San Francisco, among many other cities as well, was offered a government program to rehabilitate inner cities with federal money, and it was sort of some sort of thing to stimulate the economy at the time. And so San Francisco, there's much more to the story than this, but San Francisco ended up coming up with a plan to demolish almost the entire Western Addition and Japantown neighborhood and replace it with, low-rise and high-rise apartment buildings. And so in order to do that, they had to demolish a lot of Victorian buildings like these. These two were actually a couple that were saved, thanks to SF Heritage and other groups. About a dozen or so were saved at the very last phases of the redevelopment era. But before these two were saved, 2,500 Victorian buildings were destroyed. And a lot of them were in excellent condition and were demolished anyway. Others only needed, cosmetic upgrades, and they were destroyed also. And not only were the buildings gone, but the community is gone. The Black community, the Jewish community, the Japanese community, and all the small businesses were gone, including my father's little laundry and cleaning business that he had on 1121 Fillmore Street. And this photograph was on Fillmore Street between Post and Sutter, within the redevelopment district. And the building on the right is a building that eventually became Marcus Books on Fillmore Street. I don't know if anybody remembers that bookstore, which is not there anymore. Again, this was at the final stages of the Western Addition redevelopment. And during that era, I was an appliance repairman, and I worked almost exclusively at commercial laundry equipment and laundromats and laundries and cleaners and motels and stuff. And I would crisscross the Western Addition all the time. And, I had my camera in my glove box in my truck. And occasionally I'd have the opportunity to take these photos.
Dave, I hope you still don't keep equipment in your car. San Francisco is not the same as it used to be.
You know what? I do, but I don't keep a good camera in my car. I keep a cheap old thrift store point shoot camera. And if somebody wants to go in my car and take it, they can have it.
It means like, I'm uncomfortable photographing at Mel's, and Dave's like, I'm just leaving equipment in my car.
Dave, I'm curious, how were you feeling when you were taking these pictures? Did this sort of feel like a betrayal, or like as a Western Addition resident?
It did, but at the time, this all happened over a period of like several decades. So it was like in such slow motion that this was going on that you don't really feel the impact in the same way as you would if it just happened quickly. And just, you know, nearby from where this photo was taken was buildings that were already built to replace the demolished buildings. And what they built were these like Soviet style concrete, you know, 8 or 10 story buildings that are now gone themselves. They only lasted like a couple of decades because they were so poorly built and they were trashed by the residents. I did feel betrayal, you know, overall. But again, when it happens in over such a long period of time, you don't feel it in the same way. It's more sadness, to tell you the truth, sadness.
So you weren't a photographer who went out and thought, man, this is history in the making. I better capture this. You were just in the neighborhood and responding to what was happening around you.
But at the same time, I was working on a project with my sister and another filmmaker. My sister was a filmmaker. She went to AFI, Sephora Glass, and she worked with this guy named Scott Bartlett. And we decided to work on this project to document the moving houses at the very end of the redevelopment era. And my sister shot 16 millimeter color film, and I took still photos. So some of these photos were taken because I was, you know, actively participating in this project, but there was like many others that I took where I wasn't, and I just had the camera in my truck.
Yeah. And here's one more from Dave's redevelopment series.
Yeah, this is also on Fillmore Street.
And this is from our, ahead.
This is also on Fillmore Street, and you can see that there's some kids talking to, you know, one of the crew members, and you know, when this photo was taken, they were like in the process of moving the buildings into position where they were going to become permanent.
It's such a huge building too. It's so impressive that they're able to move buildings like this.
Yeah, and then some of the other buildings that were moved were they had to be backed into a lot in order to get them in the right position. And you know, the buildings were not only big, but they were tall. So I mean, if you look at underneath, it doesn't look like there's a whole lot holding it up, and I thought they were going to tip over. And they used to have people, you know, probably like this crew member, that would sort of keep people at a distance because, you know, they were worried that, you know, an accident could happen.
Yeah, they, you know, we used to move buildings around San Francisco a lot more than we do these days.
Sure.
It's even wilder to see them do it in like the 19 teens, let me tell you. But yeah, and we, you know, to make the connection between, you know, the work that you've done and the OpenSF History Archive, you know, we do have a lot of photos of not so much redevelopment in process like you captured, Dave, but beforehand, all of these buildings, you know, listed for demolition or before redevelopment happened. We actually have a lot of amazing photographs of a very vibrant Fillmore district that's so hard to locate on our map because the streets don't exist anymore in that same context. And Yameen, you weren't here for redevelopment, but a life-changing event that happened in San Francisco, it was the pandemic, and you were out and actively taking photographs knowing that this was a historic moment, right?
I was, yeah. And I know we talked a little bit about context and how out of place certain pictures look without the proper context. I can give an example. The other day, I saw a picture of kids carrying cardboard. And without the context, it's like, oh, there's kids carrying cardboard. But the context was that these are kids in New York carrying cardboard so they can break dance on it. And similar to that, during COVID, people eating outside, I was just so fascinated that people began eating outside, shortly after the pandemic happened, and I was taking pictures of them. But when I review the pictures now in the future, it doesn't make any sense. It's like, wow, there's people eating outside. But at the time, the context was it was during the pandemic. But here, clearly, she's wearing a face mask. And she just looks so amazing. I don't know if it's coming through in Zoom. She's wearing pink head to toe. The shoes are pink, the bag pink, pink gloves, pink face mask. So yeah, I really like this shot too.
And your work in Chinatown is really incredible as well. Chinatown being sort of a tough spot to be during the pandemic. And the empty streets, again, if you don't understand the context, seeing empty San Francisco and seeing people consciously distancing themselves from each other, you've captured it so beautifully in this series.
Yeah, thank you. This was an article I wrote on my website, yameen.com. It was right after the pandemic started to loosen up. And I think there was a vaccine on the way, and I felt a little more comfortable going to places like Chinatown, which I had never really photographed before. I had taken a couple pictures here and there, but not like with intent. And when I got there, I was really surprised that it was so empty. And that's what the series was about, was just how empty Chinatown was. And this is one of the pictures from that set. Yeah, this one as well. People beginning to play tennis with each other. Again, the context being we're still in the pandemic, but it's starting to ease up. So you see people participating in sports again.
The composition on this is incredible. I mean,
thank you.
And then this whole series at Musée Mécanique, which was incredible. Give us some background on this.
Yeah, thanks. Again, through Western Neighborhood Project support, I was able to photograph the Musée Mécanique, which is an arcade down in the Embarcadero in San Francisco. And the context was the pandemic was loosening up and they wanted to open up again. And they felt comfortable enough to open up. And I was invited to take pictures. And you can see this artist still has a face mask on, but he's painting a welcome back sign. And I saw this picture in the car that read resilient. I thought that's perfect.
And then you captured what folks were doing inside. This is Dan Zielinski, and forgive me, I forget who his longtime employee is.
Ken Eaton. Yeah, he just recently passed away, but this is inside the Musée Mécanique. And when I got in there, I thought the real story would be the arcade machines and all the old, when I say arcade machines, I mean very old machines. They have modern video games and such, but this is a really fantastic San Francisco location with lots of old games and stuff. And what I realized was the real story was happening in the back with these two gentlemen trying to fix these old machines. And this was, I think it was called the Wolitzer organ. They were trying to put it back together or something was broken. And these were my favorite pictures, was them fixing all of these old machines.
Dan has an energy that's really hard to capture on film.
Yeah, I think I wrote an article about this experience as well on my website, and I had some quotes that I wrote down as soon as he said it. I jotted them down in my phone because he's another character, a San Francisco character.
Dave, have you been to Musée Mécanique when it was in the Cliff House?
I did, and I remember Dan Zielinski there tinkering with all his machines, and they had a great collection of Nickelodeon machines, the music machines. That I don't know how they kept those things running, because I'm sure that the inner workings of those things really required some special skills to maintain and repair. But they were fantastic machines, and you're right. I mean, they were really old. I think some of them dated to the 19th century. And also, I remember Sutro's had a lot of the machines. They were like all over like Sutro's had many levels before you got down to where the ice skating rink was. And on the levels were lots of those kind of Nickelodeon machines and game machines. And like when the Nickelodeon machines, they were really loud. And sometimes there was like several of them playing all at the same time, like on top of each other. But it was a beautiful sound, even though the music kind of drowned out everything else. It's great stuff. Great stuff. But yeah, I do remember down in the basement of the Cliff House, kind of in the back.
Gotta say, hands down, maybe the best first date spot in all of San Francisco, because there's stuff for you to do, but it's cheap and you can talk about what's going on around you. It's perfect. Highly recommend. Not that I know from personal experience, of course, but yeah. And again, like to track back, you know, the work that Yameen's doing, you know, we look through our OpenSF history archive, and these photos, especially when we went through the pandemic again, these photos became extra interesting to us, right? And also helps us to date the photographs. We knew this was during World War I, during the Spanish flu epidemic, when people had to do normal things outside, like Yameen was talking about earlier. This is a church service, I think, in the Castro district. Those are parishioners outside. All these things, again, what Yameen and Dave are doing, are, and what we've seen in the OpenSF History Archive, are simpatico. And just to you know, bring that point on home, I made a point earlier about how wonderful it is that you're out there capturing with such, you know, artistic aplomb, and that makes the photograph so much more valuable. This is from a series on our archive. It's a photographer named Robert E. Lee. We don't really know much about him because, as you can imagine, that name's not the easiest to research. But it's in the late 1930s, early 1940s. He lived in the Richmond district as well and photographed what was around him. He also a car guy, took many, many photos of this car in various locations throughout the city. Also big with vernacular photography. He had a really interesting way of framing shots of the everyday scenes he saw around them, just like you too. Always, he was in Chinatown often and took these great street scenes, deserted Chinatown, and of San Francisco in the process of building. This is a building going up on Folsom and a group of men watching, I'm not sure what, but it seemed to be pretty interesting. And then again, you've got this incredible composition work. He had a beautiful eye. This is him on getting ready to get on the ferry over to the Golden Gate International Exposition, apparently fascinated with this woman's hat. And here he is at the exposition, capturing people who are enjoying this monumental event in San Francisco history. So, you know, I'm so grateful for the photographers who come before you and you two as well for capturing this city in such a beautiful way.
Well, you know, photography is a very powerful tool. I mean, it has the power to capture, you know, exaggerated emotions and split-second drama. And it's not just, you know, pictures in a frame. It's like, you know, it's scenes that are like alive with humanity and civilization and history. And I think that, you know, Western Neighborhood Project does such a great job of you know, maintaining and preserving photography and the history of photography in San Francisco. And it's such a beautiful thing that that your organization is doing.
Oh, thanks, Dave. Yeah. And if you want to follow Dave online, he's on Instagram, Dave Glass Photo. That's his handle right there. And he's also on Flickr. Highly recommend this Flickr account. And Yameen too is also on Instagram. You have a wild internet presence. You are in many different places. I'll let you explain how folks can find you, Yameen.
Yeah, film how you like. That's gotten really experimental recently. I also have a black and white, more street photography account called Film How You Black and White. But yeah, yameen.com. And just to echo what Dave said, thank you for doing all this amazing work, Western Neighborhood Projects. You do amazing stuff, and it's just awesome to be a part of it. Thanks so much.
Aw, thanks, Yameen. And Chelsea, do we have any questions before I head off into the WNP PR segment of the evening?
Not yet, but you know, we'll give people a minute to gather their thoughts.
Yeah,
I'll tell you what, I can ask a question.
Oh.
Is there a San Francisco location that either of you have not captured yet, but you really want to, but it just like not there anymore, or you can't get in, or it's just like, you know, the stars haven't aligned.
Wink.
Well, definitely. When I was high school age, you know, we lived in the Sunset and not very far from the Haight-Ashbury. The Haight-Ashbury was just this incredible scene, in especially the Summer of Love year. And I was there, you know, I mean, growing up in San Francisco, you can't not be there. It was just so much fun and so interesting, but I was too young to really visualize photographing those scenes. And I wish that I had a camera and about 100 rolls of film, because if I had, I could have captured something really good.
And you'd be rich, Dave. You mean, how about you? Where else can we get you into?
I just saw something about Treasure Island today, and it occurred to me that I don't believe I've ever been there. So yeah, I think like to hop over there and check that out.
Yeah, there is a museum on Treasure Island, and we're friends with those folks. So you let me know and I'll see what weird building I can get you into. This is one of the buildings that I'm realizing how weird this photo is to stay on for a long time. It's just like really aggressive. So I'm sorry.
Again, I feel like this is me just attracted to weird buildings. I just wandered in here and saw this, and I never knew this existed. And like, yeah, this was a fun time.
So this is the Internet Archive on, what is it, Clement and
Funston.
Funston. And for those who don't know, if you work at the Internet Archive, they make a tiny little statue of you. And it's in the big like auditorium that's there. So all of these statues represent real human beings who have worked there over time. And it's a really it's a really refined process. You have to pick like an object that represents who you are as a person. It's very stressful for some people, including a member of our board. So, and this is the perfect, I will be honest, I'm sorry, Internet Archive, these always kind of freak me out. And like this photograph perfectly encapsulates that feeling for me. Because they're pretty big. They're like half the size of a human.
All right, we do have a question. Any advice on where one could take a basic intro course on photography in San Francisco?
Yes. Well, there's City College, of course. They still have a photography program, but you know that it's a little complicated to, you know, I mean, it's like signing up to go to college, right? But if you want to do something much quicker and easier, the Harvey Milk Photo Center is a fantastic resource. They teach digital photography, film photography. They have dark rooms there. They have galleries there. And they have really good people there. And it's very, very reasonable because it's subsidized by the city. So I would definitely recommend the Harvey Milk Photo Center.
I will say, as a plug for City College, they just announced their summer programs for photography. And also, if you're working in the dark room there, you'll be using equipment formerly owned by one of our OpenSFHistory photographers, Greg Garr, who donated all of his analog equipment to the program because he also graduated from there. So plug, pluggity, plug, plug, plug. Yameen, is there any place that you can think of?
I was going to say Harvey Milk as well, yeah.
There's also, I'm going to plug PhotoWorks here in San Francisco if you're looking for like great printing and some great, there's just a great community of photographers over there who, if you hang around long enough, maybe they'll grab a beer with you and talk shop.
Yeah, any other PhotoWorks, great people over at PhotoWorks. Rhonda Smith, are you out there? I love you.
Oh, maybe she can do that. Maybe she can be our next guest on the next forum, because I also love her work, Dave.
Well, that's who I was thinking about.
Ooh, excellent. Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll talk offline about that. We don't have to create the next program during the first program, although this is working out great for me so far.
That's all for questions right now.
All right. Well, I think with that, this went a lot longer than I thought it would, which is great because this has been an incredible evening. And as one last shill for the organization so I can earn my paycheck, we are a 501c3 nonprofit. If you haven't joined this free program, I encourage you to donate to us or just keep coming to events, you know, like we do this for folks like you. So here are some events we do have coming up next. April 4th, Chelsea and I will be talking Golden Gate Park history at Academy Day at the California Academy of Sciences. This is when they celebrate their birthday, and it's totally free, or I should say pay what you can. And we'll be giving a talk about 1 p.m. So I hope to see you there. We also have another history walk coming up with John Martini of Cliff House and Sutro Baz on April 6th. And this is the one that you're the first to hear about, attendees. We're celebrating our 25th birthday again at the Four Star Theater with special guest Peaches Christ and Amanda Bartlett of SF Gate. It's going to be a prom theme. I'm going to be wearing a weird dress, and there will be punch.
And cake.
And cake. So the event listing isn't up yet, but it's coming shortly, and I hope you all can join us there. So with that, I'll say goodnight for the evening. And say thank you so much to Dave and Yameen for being with us tonight.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye. Good night, everyone. Thanks for being with us.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Good job.